Sunday, and we had decided it was stand down. There was to be no flying that day. We went into a church service. We had converted a cattle shed, a cattle stable, into a chapel, made it all fairly respectable, and we went to a service there. As we came out, there was all, as they say in the classics, all hell had broken loose. People were running round and calling and shouting, and we ran over to the ops room to find out what was going on, and we were told that 10 crews had been specially selected to go down to Brindisi for a special briefing. And we, our crew, under Lieutenant Kletty, Bob Kletty, L4, second pilot, myself as the navigator, Bob Omer, Henry Upton as one of the gunners, Eric Winchester, Senator, later to become Senator Eric Winchester, and Herbert Brown. He was the top gunner. The six of us rushed off, got our gear and flying equipment, got in the plane, and as we were idling on the side of the runway for our turn to take off, an RAF flight sergeant came running down, and he was going from aircraft to aircraft. He had his parachute in his hand, and he was saying, "Can I come with you? Can I come?" And everyone was saying, "No, no, no, away with you." When he came to us, for a reason that we never worked out why, we said, "Go and ask the colonel." And he, being a smart fella and believing we were going to go on a very easy run down to the south of France, where the second front was opening up near Marseille and that, he must have just run up, passed a couple of aircraft, come round the back of them, and he heard in us. He says, "Yeah," he says, "it's okay." Meanwhile, the colonel was down in the south tip of Italy with Brigadier Durrant, telling him that he thought an unfair risk of war, that he didn't want to risk his men and costly aircraft on an absolutely useless, futile raid. And so this chap said, he says, "It's okay." Without thinking, we said, "All right, hop in and man one of the mid-fuselage guns." We had two spare guns there. And there he came with us, and he ended up what he thought was just a couple of hour flight down the road. It took him, 10 months to get back to his home in Tunbridge Wells, Kent, in the UK. All right, that's just an interesting sideline. We got down to Brindisi and walked into the operations room of RAF 178 Squadron. And plastered on one wall, a very big wall, was a huge map of Europe. And outlined in black tape, starting from, was a route marker, starting from Brindisi, going across the Adriatic, zigzagging over 7 countries right down into the Balkans, and then right up over Hungary and over the Alps, and then dropping down into Poland. And we all said, "Geez, which crazy guys did that? I'm so glad that that's not us doing that." And of course, the briefing started with the RAF wing commander standing up with traditional words saying, "Gentlemen, your target for tonight is Warsaw." And I think we all fell about with shock. Who could, in their right senses, ask anyone to do that? Because not only at normal height of, say, 12,000 feet, we were going in at 450 feet. That is very, very low. because we were going to deliver our load to virtual street addresses. And then we heard the story, they told us the story of the Poles had risen on the 1st of August, 5 o'clock, 1st of August 1944. The Home Army rose, they had equipped themselves, and at first they captured key centers, but then Hitler ordered German Army to concentrate and crush them. And they were now being beaten up and starved out and short of ammunition and guns and all that type of weaponry. So we were being sent not to bomb them, but to bring succor, help, and arms of war. At the end of a briefing, which was extremely brave, vague, Polish squadron leader stood up and he said words like this: "I plead with you, South African and British airmen, to save my country. Poland is in dire trouble tonight, and I plead with you to help my country, Poland." Now, those are very emotional words to say, to speak to young men who are themselves on edge. We were scared. Don't get any idea we thought it was a piece of cake. We knew the danger of this. We then broke to go and catch a cup of coffee and a sandwich in the mess of the local RAF squadrons. And as we were drinking our coffee, the local chap said, "Where you off tonight?" "Oh," we said, "we're going to Warsaw." "Wow," they said, "Warsaw. Good luck, chaps, you're going to need it." We've been there a couple of nights already and we got massacred. "Good luck, cheers." Now that was our briefing. And so, you know, we weren't very optimistic. We took off. I seem to recall the mileage was 1760 miles, not kilometers. It's quite a long way. We zigzagged over seven countries. It's a never to be forgotten night in the stillness up at about 10 to 12,000 feet. When we came to the Carpathians, we had to climb to 12,000 feet to get over the icing which the cold weather would form on the leading edges of our wings. And our aircraft just seemed to take it in a stride. And then when we fell down the other side into Poland, the lowlands of Poland, we soon could see a red glow, a red ball in the sky, way ahead. And that was our target. Warsaw was in flames. There was stillness in the aircraft. All the benefit of the corporals marching us and counter-marching us in the parade ground on our initial training school came to fruition. It made us obey instructions instinctively and immediately. And there was quietness in the aircraft. Just occasionally the pilot and myself just spoke, and we were on our way. We followed instructions to avoid the area of Krakow, which is the other big city, former capital city of Poland, and Tarnów, a smaller town nearby. They reported that there were fighter squadrons stationed there. So we cut around to the east and circumvented that area. And then we dropped down to the Vistula That was stealthy, that was... And I was so busy, I just forgot. I think I must have forgotten to be frightened, but I must have been, surely. But I want you to know that God was with me. I knew that. I knew he was right there in the form of the Lord Jesus or the Holy Spirit, whichever scriptural way you care to describe God's presence. He was right there. It was there just before Warsaw when we dropped down to a very low thing. And I was map reading and talking the pilot into a position when to turn to the left. When a voice said to me, "Jones, put on your steel helmet." We used to carry a steel helmet by regulation. They were cumbersome, and there wasn't room enough in a confined aircraft to wear them. So we would take them and just throw them on the floor. But this voice came back to me a second time, as clear could be. "Jones, put on your steel helmet." So without taking my eye off where I was going and the instruments in front of me, I felt back, and fortunately I came across the steel helmet and I put it on my head, and we carried on. We saw the flak coming up. We saw the worst thing was you could see from the... What are the anti-aircraft that has bullets, lights in it? Tracers, thank you for that, the tracers. You could see the fire coming at us. You could hear it as it rolled into the aircraft. Suddenly, Henry Upton said, "Skipper, I've been hit in the arm and the shoulder, and I can no longer rotate the rear turret." That's a vital, to have a man in the end of the aircraft to watch for fighters closing in on you. And Bob quietly said to the Englishman, whose name we had learnt was Smiler Davis, "Smiler, go and pull Uppy out of his turret and you replace him and man the tail gun." We laughed afterwards because only a man of short stature could crawl along and fit into the rear turret. And we found that Davis was a fairly tall fella. And there he was trying to pull Upton out and allegedly was going to climb in. But before that happened, things took place. We came to the third bridge, and our instructions were to turn left to port. That's left on the third bridge. And we would find the concentration, the old city of Warsaw, beautiful old city, was right there. And that's how it was. And there you could just, through the haze of anti-aircraft fire, of steel fragments being fired at you, and searchlights. They were blinding. It really were terrible. And we went in, and when I thought we were spot on the place, I pressed the button and our load just fell away. They were attached to small parachutes. That was in an effort to make sure the goods we were delivering floated down safely and steadily and didn't smash on impact. And we could only trust that we had aimed correctly. And then we pulled out, and I gave Bob a southerly court course to turn on, and we were heading home. And we were certain that we were climbing out of this, but we didn't realize we had lost two engines in this maneuver. Instead of climbing out, we were falling. And the miracle was that we remained straight and level. My interpretation is that God himself got in and he was flying that aircraft, because as we fell out of the sky, thinking we were flying home, we missed all the tall trees and tall buildings, which you can see if you go to were in our path. And we leveled, we crashed onto a level piece of ground. We never spoke about crash landing. We never warned each other to get into crash landing mode, to brace up for the jolt of the thing. We had no intention of doing anything like that. We were going to get back to our squadron airfield thousands of miles away in Italy. The first I knew was I woke up and I had sand in my mouth. And I suppose I thought, that's strange. And then I realized we were on the ground. I spat the sand out and I heard Alf Falls guttural pronunciation and that, saying to Bob, "Oh, well, Davy's had it. He'll never get out of that." And I shouted out, "No, I haven't. I'm here. Get me out of this place." And Bob said, "Use the chopper. Use the chopper." And in each section of the aircraft, there was a chopper strapped onto the wall. And in the darkness, I clambered up, found where it was strapped to the wall, pulled it out, and hacked my way through the perspex and aluminium frame of the nose of a Liberator. So chop, 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 bashed my head against the thing, and there I stood on the ground, and we were on terra firma. The gunners had come out, the four of them, and they had run another way. The aircraft was on fire, and we knew we had to get away from it before it exploded. But suddenly, just as we were talking and trying to say what had happened, the searchlights on the airfield perimeter lit up and swept the ground to look for where we were escaping to. And at the same time, they raked the ground with machine gun fire, I suppose about a meter high. And we hit the deck and crept off. In one of the stories I've written, I tell you something that was true and personal. I was so scared. I was like a little boy crying out to my mother when a bigger bully was beating me up or doing something to me. And I was like shouting, "Hey, Ma, look what these guys are doing to me." Of course, my mother and our squadron were thousands and thousands of miles away. And we kept crawling along. And a German lorry, Bocky, drove right past us, and they were firing very pistol, a light hanging in the air that illuminated the ground. And they saw us and brought out the guns and hands up and all that. And we stood up with our hands in the air. That's a very humiliating thing for anyone to do. But for an airman to be on unfamiliar ground with his hands in the air isn't a sight or incident that we ever like to remember. So we were rounded up, we were taken into the control tower. And then the three of us officers were taken up to stairs in one of these circular staircases. We went up and we stood in front of the German who was the commanding officer of that airfield. And well, I'll tell you, we have memories that he had a patch on his eye, that he was festooned with German iron crosses, that's what they distinguished them. And he was writing, we think, with ostrich quill. Now, I'll tell you, that's what we thought it might have been. Anyway, he stopped writing and he looked up. And when he saw that we Luftgangsters, they referred to as air criminals, were standing with our hands at our side, he exploded, and the guards gave us a kick up the backside of that, and we shot up with our hands in the air. And he told us what he thought of us and what we were doing and all the rest of it. Anyway, he was just doing his job. And eventually we were escorted down the bottom again, and there the gunners had been brought up. And Herbert Brown was on a stretcher, mortally wounded through this wound through his side and his stomach. And he asked for water, and I believe we said no. I suppose it's not good to give a... I didn't know why we said no, but we said, no, Brownie, you're not having water. And he was taken off, and he died next day. I've omitted to tell you a vital, true, very true, it's all true, part of this. When we were shot down and we were crawling away to get away from the German troops surrounding us on Warsaw airfield, I bargained with God. What a cheek for little me to bargain with him. But we all do it, and we make promises to God. If you do this and this, I'll never touch another drink, or I'll never tell lies and things. See? God, be careful. God listens, and he always keeps his part of the bargain. And I said to him, Lord, I'm so scared. I'm petrified. Please take me back to South Africa. If you take me back safely, I'll dedicate my life to your service completely, full time. And I meant not to be a very good essential layman in the church or Sunday school teacher or something there. I meant to go in full time, and I meant it. And all of a sudden, everything went black. The hydraulics were shot away, there was no light, nothing. But we were still trying to get back to Italy. There was no question of putting the nose wheel down, we're going to land. No. We're going back home. Dear lady, I'm telling you, a miracle, aerial miracle. Because had we had one wing, just a little bit, and hit the ground, we would have gone over like that. But we're straight. Slightly downhill, and I'm in a front, knocked out, but I had to remember that helmet I got on my head now, eh? And I wouldn't be talking to you now if I didn't have that helmet there.